Hi everybody, what's up? Welcome back to the Dingo Channel. My name is Zali, and this is the fourth episode to a series where we're talking about all things dingo, from how they're different to a domestic dog to their important ecological role in Australian ecosystems. Be sure to subscribe to follow this series. Australia's largest top order land predator. Here in Australia, in the oceans, we have sharks, up north in rivers, we have crocodiles, and in the sky, we have birds of prey such as eagles. But on land, we have the dingo. The dingo has two very important functions as our top order land predator. The first one is regulating the abundance of mesopredators. Mesopredators are mid-level predators, things like foxes and cats, which are actually introduced in Australia and are pest species. They are absolutely wreaking havoc, being linked to around 22 species extinctions. The second really important function that dingoes play is maintaining healthy populations of herbivores. Herbivores are, of course, things like our grass eaters, like kangaroos. This is really important because if there is an overabundance of herbivores, there won't be enough food to go around. So the role of the top order predator is to keep everything in balance and keep it all in check. Probably wondering why our largest top order land predator is so small, with large dingoes being only around 20 kilos. To answer this question, we have to go back in time to before European settlement. Before we had things like camels, goats, cows, horses, and sheep, we only had non-hooved animals, which includes our kangaroos. So really the largest animals that we had here would be a big male kangaroo or things like the crocodile, which of course our dingo is not going to be eating. And just like all the other predators that you might be thinking about, such as lions and wolves, they only take the young of other species, which means they're definitely not going to be going after a big male kangaroo. This also answers why dingoes are not actually pack animals, because you wouldn't need a pack to take down a kangaroo joey, nor would that be enough to feed a pack. Dingoes are actually monogamous, which means that they mate for life, and the reason for this is that females have to be quite picky about the male that they choose, because they need to be sure that they can trust him to stick around and raise the young. If they don't have equal parental care, then young are not very likely to survive. So dingoes, as I said, are not pack animals, and they're usually either hunting solitarily, in a pair, or in a family group. Dingoes have to be quite tactical in their approach to taking down kangaroos. It can be quite a difficult task. In order to reserve stamina, they have to figure out who might be the weakest link, and that's the one that they will chase down. You might remember from last week's video that dingoes have incredible hearing. Dingoes are going to be using this when chasing a mob of kangaroos. The dingoes will sneak up on a mob of kangaroos, and then when they want to, they will present themselves and make themselves known. In response, the females will start to hop away. The dingo will start listening out to the one who might be struggling the most. The one that's struggling the most is usually the one with a big joey in the pouch that probably should have already moved out. As the mum is struggling, she actually will throw the joey out of her pouch. This is not very unusual for Australian marsupials. A lot of them actually do this. They will throw the baby out of the pouch towards the predator. If this joey is fast enough and strong enough, he will actually get away from the dingo, and it means that he deserves to be in the gene pool. If this joey is either ill or too slow, that will of course be the dingo dinner. This is how dingoes maintain healthy populations of herbivores, by taking out the slow, the sick, the weak, and the injured. Dingoes also don't eat very much, only consuming around 350 to 500 grams per day. They also can't digest things like fat and grain because they have completely evolved separately to the domestication process and separately to Western agriculture. The protection and conservation of apex predators across the world come with many controversies, and the dingo is no different. We already know that apex predators maintain balance within ecosystems and are therefore very important. A classic example of this are the wolves in Yellowstone National Park. There's a really famous video about this on YouTube. It's called How Wolves Changed Rivers that I would recommend checking out. Some cattle farmers across Australia have actually decided to stop shooting, trapping, and poisoning dingoes around their property. And this is because they have found that there is actually a benefit to keeping the dingoes around. Not only do they keep away feral animals, but also reduce the number of kangaroos and other herbivores, which means that there's more pasture available to cattle. In addition to this, dingoes are very territorial, so if you already have a pair of dingoes around your property, they're not going to allow foxes and other dingoes to overtake their territory. If you want to learn more about how cattle stations are choosing to coexist with dingoes, I'll leave a couple of links below. So we're coming to the end of this video now. I hope that you guys have enjoyed and that you have learned something about dingoes. It is our final episode to the series All About the Dingo, but I hope you guys will stay tuned for the future content that we have planned for this channel. Take care, everyone. See you soon.